Hello, everybody, and welcome to yet another insane edition of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. At the beginning of each year, we tend to have a basic feel for the upcoming theme, and we give it a name and then see if it plays out that way. 2015 was a year of action, and it turned out to be exactly that, also going by a secondary name of the year everyone was offended by everything. The year 2016 was a year of discovery, and in those discoveries, lots more things for lots more people to become even more offended by. So for this video, we reflect back a little on this, and we discuss why we feel that 2017 will be a year of integration. And we are going to let Richard share his thoughts first, so I will shut the fuck up.
Well, I think I can speak for all of us when I say that 2017 has gotten off to a very productive and energetic start, and that all of the things that we want are starting to happen and starting to go into flow and motion. And, you know, that's what I've been noticing with 2017. You know, it's the start of this journey with my EMT program, which I start tomorrow. I'm nervous but excited at the same time, and I know that I'll do well, but at the same time, you know, there's still that bit of false ego that we all deal with, you know, that kind of that nagging little self-doubt thing. But, you know, I ignore it, and it's there. I respect its right to be there, but, you know, I know that I'm going to do well this year, and I know that I'm going to be kicking ass in all aspects of my life, and I'm very confident that I'll succeed this term, and very confident that I'll succeed next term, and I'm very confident that 2017 is going to be a good year. But primarily, I'm noticing reflections from the universe, and I discussed this with you, Dave, a little earlier, but taking a psychology class this term, and there was a good poem in here that I read by... what was the guy's name? Charles C. Finn, I think. Scroll down to it on my page. Yep, Charles C. Finn. And I just, you know, it was a poem by the name of Don't Be Fooled By Me, or Please Hear What I'm Not Saying. And, you know, it starts out with Don't Be Fooled By Me.
Well, if you want to pop it up on screen share, feel free.
Yeah. I should do that. Let me see here. Okay. Here we go. Share. And just scrolling down here, you can see it starts off. Let me zoom in a little bit.
Yeah, that would be a good idea.
Okay. Zooming down. There we go. It says, please hear what I'm not saying. And basically, it was a poem I read today that in my chapter one of my textbook called Becoming Aware, good psychology textbook. Probably the only textbook that I've actually enjoyed delving into. Basically says, don't be fooled by me, don't be fooled by the face I wear, for I wear a mask, 1,000 masks, masks that I'm afraid to take off, and none of them is me. Pretending is an art that's second nature with me, but don't be fooled, for God's sake, don't be fooled. I give you the impression that I'm secure, that all is sunny and unruffled with me. Within as well as without, the confidence is my name and coolness my game, that the water's calm and I'm in command, and that I need no one, but don't believe me. My surface may seem smooth, but my surface is my mask, ever varying and ever concealing beneath lies, no complacence, beneath lies, confusion and fear and aloneness. But I hide this, I don't want anybody to know it. I panic at the thought of my weakness exposed, that's why I frantically create a mask to hide behind, a nonchalant, sophisticated facade to help me pretend to shield me from the glance that knows. But such a glance is precisely my salvation, my only hope, and I know it. That is, if it's followed by acceptance, if it's followed by love. It's the only thing that can liberate me from myself, from my own self-built prison walls, from the barriers I so painstakingly erect. It's the only thing that will assure me of what I can assure myself, that I'm really worth something. But I don't tell you this. I don't dare to. I'm afraid to. I'm afraid your glance will not be followed by acceptance, will not be followed by love. I'm afraid you'll think less of me, that you'll laugh and that your laugh would kill me. I'm afraid that deep down I'm nothing, and that you will see this and reject me. So I play my game, my desperate pretending game, with the facade of assurance without and a trembling child within. So begins the glittering and empty parade of masks, and my life becomes a front. I idly chatter to you in suave tones of surface talk. I tell you everything that's really nothing, and nothing of what's everything, of what's crying within me. So when I'm going through my routine, do not be fooled by what I'm saying. Please listen carefully and try to hear what I'm not saying, what I'd like to be able to say, what for survival I need to say, but what I can't say. I don't like hiding. I don't like playing superficial phony games. I want to stop playing them. I want to be genuine and spontaneous and me, but you've got to help me. You've got to hold out your hand, even when that's the last thing I seem to want. Only when you can wipe away from my eyes the blank stare of a breathing dead, of the breathing dead. Only you can call me into aliveness. Each time you're kind and gentle and encouraging, each time you try to understand because you really care, my heart begins to grow wings, very small wings, very feeble wings, but wings. With your power to touch me and feeling, you can breathe life into me. I want to know that. I want to know. I want you to know how important you are to me, how you can be a creator, an honest to God creator of the person that is me, if you choose to. You alone can break down the wall behind which I tremble. You alone can remove my mask. You alone can release me from my shadow world of panic, from my lonely prison, if you choose to. Please choose to. Do not pass me by. I will not be easy for you. A long conviction of worthlessness builds strong walls. The nearer you approach to me, the blinder I may strike back. It's irrational, but despite what the books say about man, often I am irrational. I fight against the very thing I cry out for, but I am told that love is stronger than strong walls, and this lies hope. Please try to beat down those walls with firm hands, but with gentle hands, for a child is very sensitive. Who am I, you may wonder? I am someone you know very well, for I am every man you meet, and I am every woman you meet. Charles C. Finn, September of 1966. So to put this into context, this was written over 50 years ago.
But without the randomly inserted HTML code.
Yeah, that randomly popped up. I don't know why that's there. I put the little I with the thing afterwards and that just popped up. I'll have to get rid of that. I was going to get rid of it and then I forgot about it. But, it's really funny. This has been over 50 years, and here we are in 2017, and this poem pretty much sums up, at least for me, everything that I've seen my female friends reflect to me, and probably to Dave, too. I mean, not all of Dave's female friends, and not all of my female friends, but certainly most of them, whether it be Rochelle, Natasha, and even Brianna. I've noticed all three of them have been going through these paradigms, these dichotomies, these neurotic, age-old ideas, these worn-out pretenses that so many males and females tend to put themselves in. And 2017 is the year of kind of calling this shit out. So, I mean, it's really kind of perfectly timed with everything. And it's perfectly timed with where humanity is collectively. And it's really interesting. I'm even noticing, let me get rid of my screen share here. If it'll let me. Yes, I know I'm screen sharing. I want to not screen
I think the social justice warriors have given everybody perfect opportunity for that because they're so over the top ridiculous that without them being as such, a lot of people wouldn't have the courage to speak out and be themselves. They'd remain quiet. But like in the face of that, how can you not speak out? You know, like how can you not look at it and just be like, dude, guys, really? What the fuck?
I mean, it's honestly, all of these energies have been calling out a really strong truth-telling voice for me in various situations and at various times.
I think I got it fixed here. Google was locking up on me. Okay, yep. Got things fixed here. Okay, computer, come on. Come on.
Hello, computer. Oh, a keyboard. How quaint.
Yeah, no kidding. Okay, but anyway, yeah, 2017, I've even noticed collectively in 2017, I've noticed that even mainstream talk show radio hosts are starting to kind of get more of that general realization. I was listening on the radio today, on talk radio today, and I heard one of kind of the more of the mainstream talk radio guys on there, and, you know, often in the past, I remember, you know, talk show radio hosts going into a state of blind obedience and just going to sleep after their candidate got in. Well, I'm starting to notice people, you know, that are starting to realize, okay, pulling the lever, you know, simply voting Trump, pulling the lever for Trump doesn't mean the fight is over. You know, the responsibility for the stability of this country lies within you. I'm starting to notice people saying stuff like that. And it's just like, you know, I'm noticing that people are starting to take responsibility and are starting to stand up for themselves. And, you know, it's not the status quo anymore where people are just, you know, idly sitting by and just casting their ballot for one particular candidate or the other and just doing nothing else besides that. People are actually starting to stand up and take interest in other people and are starting to stand in their sovereignty and, you know.
Finally starting to understand the misunderstood Kennedy quote, ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. Yeah. People often think that means, oh, well, blindly obey what your country asks of you, obey government. That's not what Kennedy was saying. Kennedy was saying, be the best you that you can be. Figure out what your passion is, your love is, your skills are. What are you good at? And in being the best that you can be, that is how you then do for your country. Don't beg the state for everything. Don't cast off, blame the politicians. Don't expect politicians to do everything because that leads to tyranny. So Kennedy saw that the world we live in right now was a real possibility, and he wanted to kind of cut that off at the pass, but, you know, his voice kind of went on deaf ears, and in recent times it's kind of starting to be understood what that meant. Like, oh yeah, personal responsibility. Oh, gee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. Yeah, our country is really starting to get into a state of full-on pure sovereignty. People are starting to really grasp the idea of what it means to be free. You know, being free isn't simply just being able to wake up in the morning and go on a jog and eat amazing food and enjoy the abundance of this country. Being free is doing your duty of, you know, being there for other people, being a role model in your community, and, you know, standing up not only for yourself, but for other people, people that you care about, people that you don't know, but are within the community, you know, and having, you know, critical thinking. I mean, just the state of being, having a critical mind and thinking critically and, you know, questioning everything that you hear and not just blindly believing is a state of constant patriotic rebellion in and of itself, which is healthy to society. You know, we wouldn't be a free society if we just constantly went with the status quo. And honestly, you know, a lot of people don't see it this way. A lot of people think we were better off back in the old days. But I think honestly now, I think our country is in a better state than it's ever been in that regard, because people are actually paying attention to what's going on around them, as we're opposed into the 40s, 50s, and 60s. People just blindly believed whatever the government told them to believe, and they didn't question it. They're just like, oh, the government said it, so it must be true. And, you know, why would the government lie? They wouldn't do that. You know, that would be unethical and wrong, and they wouldn't do that. If you believe that, you're just a nut job, you know.
And also within the realms of like the truth movement, people are starting to see that truthers fighting with each other is not achieving any ultimate goal, and we need to get more curious and ask more questions and be willing to have civil conversations rather than dick wags. And even like in the spiritual communities, instead of, oh, love and light, shun the dark, go into denial, they're starting to realize that shining their light in a dark place is how you make the world better, not like ignoring everything and hoping it goes away because the secret, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ask, believe, and receive opportunity for you to use the tools to do things for yourself. Not ask, believe, and receive the car magically appearing in your driveway for no reason because unicorns. Personal responsibility always seems to be like the missing key in the New Age movement.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I'm even starting to realize that for myself personally, you know, it's like the path to what I want, it's not the classes, it's not that the classes are hard or that the work's too much or that, you know, the math is too hard or, you know, the EMT stuff is too hard or, you know, anything like that. It's the biggest hindrance to my success is my belief systems. And if I have neurotic, fucked up belief systems, or I maintain these old neurotic ways of thinking, and this applies to anybody, you're not going to be successful. And when I read that chapter today, it was synchronistically perfect because I was kind of stressing out a little bit today. You know, it's like beginning of new chapters, turning the new leaf, you know. Yeah, that can be kind of a pressuring process. You know, you're jumping into a new frontier, a new abyss, you know. You're leaping off the cliff again. It's kind of like, you know.
So integration is using the contrast as being like nitrous in the gas tank instead of feeling like it's victimizing you.
Yeah, it's an opportunity, not a burden, you know. And I was telling myself that today, and you know, I was like, you know, and I didn't have math homework tonight. She didn't give us math homework tonight, and we're not going to get it until Wednesday, so you know, that was kind of cool. But you know, I was like, well, I need to read the psychology professor wants us to read our first chapter before we meet on Friday, so I decided to take the liberty and do that as my kind of homework for today. And you know, I read it and I went from a state of like all nervous and kind of to like just kind of at peace and ease. And you know, I just read through that chapter and it's like, you know, it was kind of a reiteration of what 2016's been and what 2015's been for me. And kind of just, it was kind of a culmination of everything. And it was just kind of, you know, I was thinking through my mind and all of that stuff. And it just kind of, you know, just clicked. It was like, okay, so what I need to do is, you know, the biggest hindrance to my success is me. It's not anybody else, you know. It's not the professor, it's not anybody else, it's myself. And if I don't take personal responsibility and I don't do what I need to do, I'm not going to succeed and I'm not going to do what I want to do. But if I take responsibility and I act, you know, act on, you know, what I want, what I demand of reality, and, you know, I go with true grit and I push for that, and it's like, no, this is what I want. I'm putting the chess piece here on the chess table. That is what I'm doing, and you can't stop me. You know, I shape my reality. I shape my destiny, not the other way around.
Well, Paul and Katerina, what contrast have you guys been integrating so far in 2017 and moving more into that nitrous in the gas tanks, you know, road to success, instead of feeling victimized by every little thing?
what before, and before it's, I would love to stay on and hear what Katerina and Paul have to say, but it's hitting 11:30 and I really need to wind down.
Yeah, go to bed, man.
It's all good. You know, we will definitely be having a lot more hangouts and speaking in a lot more detail about a lot more different subjects. So, you know, we'll just catch you the next time around on it.
Yeah, it sounds good. But yeah, when it comes to new leaves, I'm headed right on out to doing new leaves tomorrow. So I've first day of emergency medical technician training ends tomorrow.
Yeah. Go you.
Mm-hmm. Hey, you've already climbed a wall, literally, so hey.
Yeah. My brother-in-law is an EMT and very successful at it, and it's a good job for somebody like you who loves to learn, because there's a lot of just hanging around waiting for somebody to call 911.
Yeah, and then there's those nights where it's like, God, I wish people would just stop calling 911. Oh, why don't you help me there, Sonny? My old ankle is all
swollen
up and I just shit down my leg.
The social justice warriors are throwing bricks through windows again in protest of hate speech and blah, blah. Uh-oh. 911's ringing off the hook.
Okay, Tina, we're going to get you up onto the gurney, okay? We need you to put this aspirin in your mouth. We know that you were... Yeah, you just need to take a deep breath. You need to stop cursing at the top of your lungs. Hey, don't yell fuck you at me. It's all right. We're going to get you into the hospital. You're having a massive coronary. You need to calm down. No, don't be flinging your SJW poop in my face. That's not, no.
It's technically assault.
That's technically assault. And if you do it again, I'm going to have an officer handcuff you to this gurney.
And I will put the narcotics key away. I've just gotten the narcotics key out. You don't want me to put it away, do you?
But we have a problem. The cuffs won't fit. What do we do? Okay, get out the hemp rope.
If the cuff don't fit, you must acquit.
Too legit to acquit. Hey. Anyway.
Yeah. I'll catch you guys later. So
yep.
Talk to you later.
You have a good night.
Yeah, you guys
bye,
too.
Love you.
Hey, Katerina. Love you too. Have a good night, Paul.
Have a good night, Red.
Catch you next time.
Yep.
Notice how I'm the only one that Rich says he loves.
Yeah, well, you have, you know.
You have nicer breasts than I do. I have no breasts. I don't
want like I'm like an A cup. I've been trying since puberty. I don't know. Seriously. And the shirt's just not flattering to it. I mean, honestly.
So guys, as per my original question, what's integration contrast have you guys been experiencing to kind of put that nitrous in the gas tank that's been triggering the crap out of you, but you've just been doing it like a boss?
Well, what integration contrast haven't we experienced yet in 2017? The 2017 has been a very interesting year. 2017 is the very
we're
first
10 days in.
I know, we're 10 days in. So you know, we have been experiencing a ton of contrast, but at the same time have been experiencing this inner peace like nobody's business, because we realize that we're being able to create. You know, it's like I spent my whole life reinventing myself, and finally I decided that for 2017 I would just reinvent myself as who I am instead of who I pretend to be. So
yeah. And you guys also got to get some more money, power, sex episodes going there too. You guys kind of been not doing a lot of that,
like looking inward and being like, "What the fuck are we doing?" kind of a thing. But shedding. Yeah. And we weren't sure if we were going to shed money, power, sex, or if we were going to continue to do it. And we've decided that we're going to continue to do it. And what we're going to do, and we basically figured out what we're going to do with it, because we are so ruthless about decluttering stuff in our lives that if we don't have a purpose for something, we just stop doing it. We get rid of it. And because money, power, sex was something that was a bit of a coming out for the both of us, as far as, like, you know, we're like, hey,
we like kinky sex,
we'll talk about pedophilia on the internet, whatever, we just don't care.
Continue coming out, all the innuendos everywhere.
Right. So it's been interesting, because one of my fears about being the person who I know that I am on the inside,
being my actual self,
is that people wouldn't accept me because or that I could have some secrets that would come out. And I'm like, how do you not have any secrets that come out? You just tell them on the internet. There, now it has no power over me.
There you go.
Easy.
It's like, okay, there that is. Now there's nothing to come out. So no harm, no foul.
Yeah, no harm, no foul. And I feel like, I mean, I've always...
Somebody tries to say anything, then it's like, yeah, and I already admitted that on YouTube. So, like, what's your point? The sky's blue, the grass is green, and is there some place you were trying to go with this?
Exactly. And finally, the fact is that I'm seeing, at least on my Facebook feed, just this revolution of all these personal coaches. And I'm looking at these people, and every single one of them has the same rags-to-riches story, and every single one of them also has themself up on a pedestal, and I'm like, man, you guys are just like heading for a really hard fall, because eventually somebody is going to discover something about you that you don't want them to discover, and when that occurs, there goes all of your credibility. Like, I would like to establish credibility from a position of complete humility. Hey, this is where I am, this is what's going on in life. And 2017 is a big year for that, because I feel like I finally got the stick all the way out of my ass and just loosened up on the internet and just talk
also
about
in real life. Like,
and, yeah,
I mean, internet is just a reflection of how you are in real life.
Right. And
what's
so
the difference, though? The internet's a part of real life. It's real life people interacting for real.
And so, yes. Like, it's online is just a reflection of offline, though.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, people like to think the internet isn't real life.
I know.
Oh, it's a part of real life. Okay, well, it was a good opportunity for me to point that out, because so many people are in that line of thought. Like, oh, online is not real life. It's like, oh, yeah, go ahead and fuck up online and get those real life consequences. Then you'll see just how real.
We were watching the South Park episode of, it was like the very last one, right? Like,
yeah,
the very last ones about
trolling on the internet.
It was just so funny, and then like all of this crazy shit that happened in real life because of the trolling that was happening on the internet, and like just the insanity that was happening.
Yeah, it was awfully funny. And yet another way that we're integrating is that, you know, for probably the past 10 years, I haven't really allowed myself to watch TV shows and enjoy them.
Like South Park, which
like South
I love.
Park, which is witty as hell. I mean,
I love it.
Yeah. So
you're choosing to get the stick out of your
I'm
butt
choosing to get the stick out of my
fun.
Ass and like allow myself to have some fun. I live in motherfucking Maui. Come on now.
Right. Like, how many more comments do you need to have?
You're pulling it out so that Katerina's shovel can have some company.
Right.
So lose the shovel.
Yeah. I don't know if he ever saw that part, that video.
I don't know. Show him if he hasn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I feel like 2017 is a huge year of integration. And I view integration as being like
the Paul you were before the world ruined you.
Right. The me that I was when I was like six.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just about to be in six. That's all.
Yeah.
But with the adult knowledge
With the adult knowledge, right. Like,
but
every
not like, ooh, fire shiny.
Oh. Mikey, electricity. Oh, touch that bare copper wire. Ooh, damn it. Ow. Yeah. But I feel like every adult has had the fantasy of like going back and being a child, like, but with your adult knowledge, I'm like, wait,
you
I don't
can do that.
You can just do that.
Drop your paradigms.
So half the reason that I took this sales job was so that I could go do that. So it's really just practice at being myself. You can't sell shit unless you're being yourself. And you actually have to give a damn about your clients. That's really all there is to sales. It's not all about techniques and tricks.
It's about caring.
It's about giving a fuck about people. That's all it's about.
For me, integration is about duality balanced in harmony instead of like that polarization. Like, so many people are so utterly polarized that, you know, they not only pit opposites against each other, but they like to do what I refer to as fake balance, because there's real balance, which is harmony, then fake balance, which is based in opposition. Fake balance, I picture it as like you're standing there with your arms fully stretched out and there's a big lead weight in each hand and you're trying to keep your arms level. I'm balancing. No, that's not balance. Balance and harmony is like how the strands of DNA naturally wrap around each other without struggling. You know, harmonious balance is that the wind doesn't need any help blowing and the grass grows without anybody having to get out and push, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And when we, and like the idea of integrating light and dark, for me, that's very simple. You shine a candle in a dark place, and there you go. A lot of people think, oh, I need to ignore the darkness, shun the darkness. I can only shine my candle in a place that's already bright as fuck. It's like, doesn't that defeat the purpose? Like, does anybody go, oh, look at this already well-lit room. I think it needs some more light. I'm just going to break out all the candles in this already well-lit room. Or do they think, oh, this room is kind of dim. Let's turn on a light or light a candle or whatever. Let's brighten it up. So we don't look at the dark room and go, oh my God, I need to run away from that and shun that so that I don't give power to it. You know?
Yeah. Like whenever you go into somebody comes into your life, the very first thing that you say is, how can I help this person? Not how, what part of this person can I ignore?
Mm-hmm. Or how can I just be myself and hopefully that inspires who it's going to inspire?
Yeah. Yeah. Katerina and I have been having an ongoing conversation about evangelism. Now, evangelism.
That's another thing. People trying to always fix everybody.
Right.
It's like,
work.
When you view everybody as broken, that's totally dysfunctional, because then that's saying what I think is best for me is best for everybody. So Zig Heil, I'm going to fix everyone. I'm going to force everyone into my way and tell them that if they're not doing it in my way, which is the only right way, then they're broken and they're delusional or whatever, when that's just pure, you know, Nazism at its core. For me, I think it's better to just, you know, figure out who I am and figure out what's the best way of going about things for me, see what works and what doesn't, and then in that way act as an example that people can look at and go, okay, that's working for him or that's not working for him or whatever, to help them in their own decision processes of, okay, what's going to work for me and what isn't. Not, oh, I must do things Dave Kelso's way because he is my authority, and not, oh, Dave Kelso must do everything my way because he knows nothing and I'm the almighty whatever, you know, none of that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's simply a matter of being like, hey, this worked for me and maybe it'll work for you and maybe it won't. And I don't really care. I'm just telling you this works for me and I'm living it and you can look at the results and decide for yourself. It's like, you know,
totally.
You go to your favorite restaurant and you pick up something new on the menu and you're like, holy shit, this is amazing. And so every time you go in there, you get it yourself and you recommend it to your friends because you're like, whoa, this is the best thing on the menu. It's not like, this is the thing that I eat and because you eat something different, you're a terrible person, or this is what I eat, so I'm going to force it down your throat too and you don't have a choice.
Yeah.
So what I eat, if you like it, cool.
Then there's the people that don't realize that they get off on feeling as if they're broken. So they feel that they need to go to a guru to tell them how to live. But the funny thing is like the worst thing that could happen to these people is when they actually find a quote unquote so-called guru that actually does have practically applicable answers that really actually can help them. Cause then what I've seen happening, and like Katerina, you and I have experienced this one with Mike Gardner a long time back. You know, as soon as people like that see any sense of personal empowerment, they try to force the person they see as a guru to reflect their brokenness and their victimization back to them, and they start asking things like, okay, well, I'm so broken when I do this this and this. So how can I be less broken because I'm so broken? And it's like, well, you know, just consequences, you know, for actions. Just, you know, do the best you can and be the best person you can be. But I can't because I'm broken. It's like, well, yes, you can. You're just choosing to view yourself as broken. So you have, you know, taking these actions which have these consequences, which then you point to validate your sense of brokenness and continue to cycle in it. But no, I am broken. And you need to reflect to me that I'm broken. And it's like, me and Katerina both just kept telling that guy, that's not what we're here to do. I'm not, you know, we're not here to justify your sense of brokenness to you. Sorry, we're not looking to keep you addicted to your victimization. We're just here to share our perspectives, and you can agree with them or not or whatever, and that's fine. But we're not here to be your babysitter or your boss or your mommy or your daddy. You came to us with questions. We're answering them from our perspective, not as an authority, but just we're honestly telling you what we think, and that seems to not be what you want to hear, and you're trying to force us to tell you what you want to hear, and that's not going to work. And then he ended up, you know, blocking us after a while because, you know, we weren't giving him what he wanted. But there's a lot of people in that trap too, that addicted to professional victimhood. And that's the way that's why a lot of the social justice warriors are the way they are. They don't want to hear anything about the races being able to cooperate or the genders being able to respect each other. They just want to shout, I'm a victim and you must bow to me because you're the perpetrator and you must make up reparations to me because I'm such a victim. They don't want to hear, hey, how about everybody just get along? Oh, no, I don't want to hear that. That's hate speech. What? Really? Saying, let's just all respect each other? That's hate speech? Oh, get this hate speech out of my campus. You know, it's just like, yeah. Whatever. Victimization can be addicting.
Totally.
So I know recently, Katerina, you had an interesting experience where there was some church you actually went to that was filled with hippies and nice people and little kids painting your nails and everything like that. Yeah. And I mean, we're all aware of Christian fundamentalism and not wanting to get into that, but this church was apparently full of cool people. So
they have authenticity as part of their core ethos.
Cool.
Which is like, was really cool to me because I view myself as a Christian as well, but I'm a person who believes more so of like what Jesus actually taught, not like what we've seen in terms of like hippie Christians, you know?
Yeah.
And there's a lot more people out there like me. And I just met a bunch of people who were like me in the sense that they were totally over hippie Christianism and are interested in authentic Christianity and authentic living of what Jesus taught and really like loving thy neighbor and not judging other people and not like excluding other people and not like hurting other people just because of what they believe, you know?
Yeah. I find it funny that sometimes the hippie Christianism can get so thick that you've got different denominations of Christianity that are insisting that their denomination is the one and only true Christianity and that all the others are not actually Christians. Like,
This is a non-denominational church that I went to.
Yeah. And like the one of the popes was saying that Catholicism is the only one true religion, and then Lutheran Missouri Synod responded back, oh, the Pope is the office of the Antichrist. And yeah, as funny and witty as all that is, it's dysfunctional. And then sometimes,
because it confuses the followers and it makes followers feel divided, you know, so
Yeah.
The thing is that I feel like all of us followers of these teachings, I mean, the Bible is filled with amazing knowledge, amazing stuff that is really, really nourishing to the human spirit and the human soul. But, you know, the Bible isn't the only text out there that's nourishing to the human soul. Mm-hmm. Also, it's like I would be mistaken if I thought that the Bible was the only one true thing.
Yeah. But and the Bible is also, especially the Old Testament, filled with a lot of hateful bullshit, like own slaves and beat your daughter and you know, commit genocide against enemy nations and like all this other like crazy stuff.
Yeah, it's definitely a theatrical thing. But, you know, the thing is that all the holy texts have their stuff in it. And they're old school. Like, this is old ways of doing stuff. And obviously, yeah, it doesn't jive with our modern day, like, safe space, you know.
Give the Philistines some safe space. Hashtag don't crucify.
Don't crucify me, bro. Jesus.
Yeah, I always tell people if Jesus came back as an individual person, we'd crucify him again. We'd kill him again. Maybe it wouldn't be literally up on a cross, but we'd do something to fuck him over, kill him, or put him in jail, or whatever. And it's just like,
he wasn't popular.
We'd do it again. We would totally do it again.
And honestly, Dave, I feel like the second coming of Christ is us. Like, I think I believe Christ consciousness is what it is. It's like, I feel like Christ imbues himself into people. And that's why there's like this overlap with like this awakening stuff that's happening. I don't know if I'm going to do these beliefs of mine. So this is kind of vulnerable.
Cool.
Here you go.
I support your belief.
I mean, I completely agree with that too. And, you know, for Christians saying, oh no, he can only come back as one man, it can't be the Christ consciousness thing. I'm like, well, aren't you kind of limiting Christ? You're saying that Christ can't imbue 7 billion people. Like, that's too big of a thing for him to do. Like, you know, he's not allowed to do that. That's off limits for Jesus. It's like, are you really, you know, putting him in this tiny bottle of limitation? And then I say, and if he did come back as one person, we'd just kill him again.
Right. Like, there would be no point. But the thing is that what I'm seeing on the planet these days, especially now that it's 2017, I'm seeing this level of understanding and general tolerance and acceptance happening, even in spite of all of the crazy drama. Like, I feel like the crazy drama is inciting more of this compassion and more of this acceptance and more of this tolerance.
Yeah.
Because and hearts are starting to be more aware and be more sensitive. Like it's almost as if the layers are falling away from our hearts, and it's really uncomfortable for a lot of people, and it's causing a lot of people to face a lot of their paradigms and to feel very insecure and very defensive and very pained by what they're experiencing in life. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's almost as if we're walking around like, and we're just like open wounds, and a lot of us don't know how to deal with that. And, you know, even me, like, I've had a lot of experience with dealing with my emotions, and it's been intense for me too. Like, I've just been feeling like opened on a whole new level. You know, my asshole feels like it's whole new levels of stretched, you know. And it's exciting and it's terrifying, but at the same time, I know that the only way that I can really navigate this time is through surrendering and choosing to let go of the need to control things and the need to look a certain way or be perceived a certain way, as I used to feel. Like, my need of to people please has dramatically reduced. My need to over explain myself has really, really reduced. And it's just like, I'm noticing these attitude shifts in me that I feel are a product of like what's kind of happening on the planet. Like, I don't feel like this is me consciously choosing to make these choices and choose this stuff. It's like, I am, but I'm not. It's like, I feel like something is influencing me to rapidly upshift in the way that I see life.
everybody influences everybody else. I mean, that's kind of unavoidable. That's why being an example of the change we want to create is important because we can influence people. I mean, at first, usually we're, you know, going to trigger the fuck out of them, because when somebody thinks that misery is the only real reality and they've been taught to rage against contradictions and defend paradigms and go, no, this is the way it is. I'm right. I'm almighty. This is the one and only one way it is. Then if they have a view like, oh, you know, kindness is creepy and friendship can't be real and everybody's out to get you and blah, 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 all this and other stuff, then, like, you know, being kind to somebody is like one of the most creepiest, freaky things that you can do to, like, trigger them and freak them the fuck out. You know, goes back into the problem is there is no problem, because they're like, no, you can't be kind to me. You must be up to some nefarious agenda, because misery is all that exists and I'm sticking by that. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, they don't. Yeah, they don't want that to be their belief system. Like, nobody trapped in that belief wants that to be their belief. They didn't wake up like, yeah, I want misery to be the only real reality. That's what I want. They want the opposite of what they believe, but they won't let themselves have it.
But the reason that they won't let themselves have it is because anytime that they've tried to in the past, it's like there's been these levels of mistrust and being betrayed and having the wool pulled over their eyes and, you know, having these experiences that were highly traumatic for these mm-hmm. people to believe these things, because I was a person that believed these things. I believed
what you're saying.
It was a slow process of learning to trust God. It was a slow process of learning to trust other people. It was a slow process of learning to accept and allow love in and to receive kindness without feeling like I needed to shudder or brush it away.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember what happened at the store?
I think one of the big problems is we're so quick to be understood and not so quick to be understanding, so that, like, when we're in our fit of justification going, I need to be understood, blah, 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 then when somebody else is doing the exact same thing and they are in their fit of, I need to be understood, blah, 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 then we take that as an attack against us, and then they take what we're doing as an attack against them. And so it's like squirrel in the car mirror, negative feedback loop thing. And so we misunderstand that many of the people that we view as being attacking and betraying, they're not. It's just that they're doing exactly what the fuck we are doing. And when two people doing that are doing that to each other, it just creates this snowball effect of victimization.
Yeah. What were you saying?
There's a story that something happened to Katerina and I just yesterday, I believe, when we went to the grocery store. And the first lady, we went and got some food there at their little restaurant in the store. The lady who took our order, we were just having a blast. We were just having so much fun. We were on the high-flying disc. And the lady who took our order was not. And so she was, like, kind of downright frightened and slightly threatened by my behavior in particular, because she felt like a man wouldn't be trying to, like, have a good time with her and just, you know, have fun with her unless I was somehow a threat. Mm-hmm. And so she was a little bit, like, standoffish, to the point where she physically removed herself from the situation by hiding in the back for a little while. So I went and paid for the thing, came back, and another lady was up front. And so I just started talking to her. And this girl, you know, or this older woman was like,
are these people that work there or fellow customers?
People that work there.
Okay.
So they have to deal with me. They get paid to deal with me. Okay. No escape. So this other woman was far more willing to engage and play, and so she just started playing with Katerina and I, and then when the first one realized it was safe and that people could just have a good time and enjoy each other's company even at the grocery store where it doesn't typically happen, you know, once she realized that was safe, she came out, and she came out of her shell.
Yeah, and then we were able to all play.
And then we all played together. It was fun, because Katerina and I are a blast when we go out.
Yeah, we go around and make jokes and talk to people and have fun. And Like,
yeah, it's like
we're so open with each other. We invite other people into that openness with us.
Yeah, the same conversations that we have on PSEC, like we totally have those in line at the grocery store.
Cool. My dad, for the longest time, has done something similar in grocery stores. He's usually quite chatty and playful and you know, jovial with the staff. And every once in a while, he'll, you know, he'll end up running into a clerk or something who's more than just a little bit Nazi-istic, more than just a little harsh, feeling more than just a little threatened, and it'll start getting domineering with my dad. And you know, you don't do that to a Vietnam vet who is pushing 70 and who feels that he's done quite a bit for his country. So he'll just straight up say, hey, you know, First Amendment, free speech, I'm allowed to be who I am. If you don't like it, fuck you. He'll say it like right like that.
Awesome.
And then one time it's like this one lady was like, oh, you can't swear in the store like that. He's like, yes I can, it's a free country, First Amendment. You know, I'm a customer. It's like, I'm not bothering anybody, you just have an attitude with me and I'm saying fuck you, that's all. You expressed how you feel, I'm expressing how I feel. And it's funny because like you know, she was trying to I remember what it was. My dad was trying to buy a bottle of alcohol, and I guess he left his I forgot if he left his driver's license in his car or if he was just felt like being a troll and didn't feel like showing it. He was just like, look at me. Do I really look like I need to show you ID? Do I really need to do I look like I need to prove that I'm 21 years or older? Like, seriously, do I really look under the age of 21? He's like, I'm not showing you the ID. And she tried to press on it, right? So he put the bottle of alcohol aside and said, I'm not buying it then. I'll go somewhere else and I'll buy it. Because it's fucking ridiculous to tell someone who's pushing 70 and to look at them. It's obvious. It's ridiculous to say, oh, I'm sorry, I can't let you buy this unless you show me your ID. It's like, well, fine, I just won't buy it here then.
Now you have to go put it back. Notice how you just made more work for yourself? How did that work out?
Yeah, exactly. Like, yeah, I won't buy it then. But people get so funny. And you know, my dad doesn't usually have this problem. He obviously looks old. He obviously is, and people never card him. But every once in a great rare while, he run into someone that just wants to try to assert their authority, and they're acting like, oh, I'm going to show everybody that I'm the boss of this situation. And my dad just likes to be like, hey, guess what? You're not the boss of this situation. You're just someone with an attitude problem.
That's great. It reminds me of I had just gotten out of jail in Colorado, and they put me in this room with this lady who had a serious attitude problem. She's talking to me about stuff, and I guess I'm being a smart ass because that's what I do. Even right after getting out of jail, I'm still a smart ass.
Here's a question: why were you in jail, if I may ask?
I was in jail.
I can't imagine you going to jail.
A court appearance that I had put off for like 6 months, and the judge was just so mad by the time I had just trolled the judge so hard. The judge was just like, you go to jail now.
And what was this court thing for? Some minor parking ticket or what?
It was a very minor violation of driving without a license, registration, or proof of insurance.
Okay. And if I may ask, why did you not have any of that?
I was Poe.
Okay, so at the time you just couldn't afford to get that stuff, but you chose to drive anyway.
I was earning $9 an hour and I had a sports car. Eh.
He was Poe.
I was Poe. Yeah.
But some things were important in life.
Yeah, and alcohol was more important to me at that juncture than any driver's license. You know. So anyway, that's how I ended up in jail. It was less than 24 hours. They spat me out so fast that the jailer could not handle me because I followed all the rules, like, to the letter. And, man, yeah, there is nothing that infuriates them more than following all the rules.
Oh yeah, totally. I love when I'm confronted by an arrogant cop, I do the kill him with kindness thing. I'm just like sickeningly sweet, polite, because there's no law against being too nice. So they really can't do anything, but they know I'm trolling them and just being a complete dick in a polite way, but I have plausible deniability because they know that I know that what I'm doing is aggravating them, but there's just no law against being, you know, too polite. And there's one time where this one cop, like, I forgot the exact thing, but you know, he didn't like my air of confidence. So he decided he was going to try to take me down a few notches and thinking, okay, well, you know, this guy's just must be just putting on a pretense. So if I get up in his face, he's going to do something stupid and give me a reason to arrest him, you know? So he gets all up arrogant in my face and, oh, well, did you know this? And like some sort of like crazy scene out of like Miami Vice or something. I felt like I was in a fucking movie or something. It was really like bizarre. And the only thing I was afraid of was not being able to hold back my laughter, because inside I just wanted to bust out laughing so hard because of the way this guy was acting. But I was just keeping a straight face and just everything he said. Oh, yes, sir. No, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. No, sir. Okay, sir. I understand, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir. And he stormed off pissed. Like he saw that he was not going to get a reaction out of me to give him an excuse to lock me up. So he just like stormed off because I was, again, just following everything to the letter and not giving him any trouble, despite the fact that he was getting up in my face. So that was pretty hilarious.
Interesting. Yeah, so to continue the story, after when I was in the room with this lady, she's like, she looks at me and she says, you realize that I have the power to put you back in jail, right? And I said, well, that would actually be pretty nice. I haven't had a vacation in a while. And I mean, like, you guys feed me in there. The water is hot. There's no bills. There's no rent. And all my money is just earning interest in a bank account while the state is paying to feed me. So go ahead, put me back in jail. And she was so mad. She was so enraged.
Because you were unfuckwithable.
I was just unfuckwithable. Like, okay, well, put me back in there. Like, I learned so much in jail. Like, I met the neatest people.
Your finger peeking out all the time.
That was the other thing I told her. I said, I met the most interesting people. You can bet I'll be networking that with them now that I'm out of jail. Yeah. But if you'd like to spend your tax dollars to put me back in there, that's totally okay. It's just how high do you want your tax bill to be?
That's funny.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But just not being able to be messed with when somebody who is like in a position of minor authority tries to lord it over you. It's hilarious. Mm-hmm. Like, seriously, I was out of jail within 24 hours. How much power do you really think you have to put me back in there? Not a lot.
Yeah, and you made it clear that if you went back in there between the two of you, the only one that's going to feel inconvenienced isn't you.
Right, she's gonna have to fill out the paperwork.
And deal with your app.
And deal with me.
Yeah, exactly.
Want a repeat of this? I'm the person who made you feel bad today. Sorry.
And you made her feel bad by not feeling bad yourself, because misery loves company, and you didn't give misery any company.
Exactly. It was funny when you said that. And now I feel like actually just yesterday I had an interaction with a police officer. I went to the bathroom behind where I work, which is I go in there. There's a police officer using the bathroom, and this restroom has a key on it, so it's a lockable door. It's not like it's open to the public.
Yeah.
And the homeless people are known to go in there and do drugs.
IV drugs.
And so that's why we keep it locked. And so I walk in there and I'm all dressed up nice, you know, from selling art. And I see the officer come out. I'm like, oh yeah, how's it going, officer? He said, it's going good. I said, so how am I supposed to do IV drugs if you're actually in here? Like, I'm supposed to be like kind of discreet. You're actually in my drug den, and yeah, I'm gonna have to ask you to leave.
I mean, you let him know you were kidding, right?
No, No, I think the fact that I was wearing a polo made it clear that I was kidding. Yeah, and he's like, here, man, I didn't see a thing. He was cool.
He got the joke.
Obviously. Seriously, yeah. I walked out of the art gallery.
Yeah, but that one lady, from what you were saying in the jail, reminds me of something that happened to me when I was dealing with the whole, you know, fence witch thing back in the day when I had this, you know, psychotic neighbor next door that we nicknamed Fence Witch. I'm not going to go into the whole story, but let's just say that the property owners were renting, and they ended up renting to very much the wrong person. Really nasty individual. So, you know, she would call the cops on us for like every little thing. I mean, no joke, we'd water the lawn and she'd call the cops, like any little thing. So the cops really didn't know, they couldn't feel out which one of us was and wasn't full of shit, and they were getting sick of getting called back. In fact, we would joke around and say, oh, look, the babysitters are here, when the cops came up. And they'd be like, what do you mean? It's like, well, she's using you as her personal babysitters, so, you know. Or we'd say, oh, have you come to protect us from the terrorists living next door? You know, things like that. And there was one time this one cop decided to get really cocky, because there's this one section of the public easement that's kind of shared between private and public. You know how that goes. You got the front lawn, then the sidewalk, then the grass easement, and whatever. And, you know, we built, you know, like a flower box thing there. And, you know, we had bushes and trees and flowers and, you know, all nice and decorated. And this one cop decided he wanted to be all authoritative and everything. And he's like, he's looking at me and he's like, okay, now, I could, if I wanted to, I could just go and grab onto those plants in there and just pull everything out, because that's public property, and I'm a cop, and I could do that if I want to, but why would I do that? Why would I do that? And I said, I don't know. That would be a really stupid thing to do, and only a moron would do that, and you look like a really smart man. I don't know why a man as smart as you would go and do something that completely stupid. So I don't know. Why would you do that? That doesn't make any sense to me at all. He's like, okay, let me rephrase this. If I were to go in there and grab one of those bushes and yank it out, you probably wouldn't like that very much, would you? That's not something that you would like. That's not something you would want me to do. And I said, no, that would kind of suck, and I wouldn't want you to do that. But I must admit, there is one aspect of it that I think would be absolutely hilarious, because when you would grab your bare hands tightly around the wild rose that I have growing in there, and all those thorns go right into your hands, and they'd be able to hear you screaming down the block, I have to admit that that would actually be extremely funny. And that's when he decided to, you know, just kind of leave.
Right. We have gardening gloves for a reason. Oop, they've dropped. Woohoo, I'm all alone.
Sorry, I got punted, but I'm back now. Yeah, I got punted by Google for a second. It happens to Rich way more than it happens to me, but I guess it was just my turn or whatever, but I'm back now.
Okay.
But yeah, you were saying something, Paul? He's Paul still there?
Right now. Hang on a second.
Ah, okay. Not a problem. But yeah, getting back to this being, you know, a year of integration, I mean, just the idea of integration where we take this contrast, and instead of moving into an idea of, oh, you know, we have to avoid that negative thing or fight that negative thing that, oh, I'm a victim and we need to have psychopathic babysitters lorded over us and whatever else, moving into seeing things more as opportunity instead of burden and thinking, all right, you know, how can we use this as nitrous in the gas tank? How can we take this shit and use it as fertilizer to, you know, grow ourselves that garden of positivity that we're wanting, and, you know, moving into greater realization of personal responsibility and out of this poor little me attitude. And I think the more that the powers who assume they be fight each other to struggle to consolidate power, and tyranny gets more transparent, the social justice warriors do their thing and whatever, it's kind of just like the dark in service to the light, for lack of a better way of saying it, because it's forcing more and more people to wake up and start thinking along lines that, you know, they never thought of before. Like, for example, take Trump, for example. Whether you love or hate Trump, he's definitely got people thinking about things they never thought of before, and really, you know, just taking things into consideration that they had never taken into consideration before. So even just as far as topics and speaking points, you know, and all of that, he's kind of been stirring the pot, as Tobias Lars likes to call it. And, you know, all this stuff comes up so that we have to face it and take personal responsibility and deal with it instead of keeping it pushed down and ignoring it and letting things fester and doing the same old, same old. So, you know, 2017 seems like it's going to be a really big year for that sort of thing, both on the individual personal level for each of us in our own lives, as well as collectively. So I think it's just going to be an extremely interesting year.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a very interesting year too. I mean, all of these personalities, all of these extreme personalities are born of other extreme personalities. And I feel like the pendulum swings one way and then it swings the other way, but eventually it comes to rest in the middle. And 2017 is one of those coming to rest in the middle kind of years when things are stable. I think 2017 is going to be a year when, at least for me personally, like my life is going to be very stable comparative to 2015 and 2016.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't, you know, when I, you know, got the feeling that this is going to be the year of integration, like, you know, when I was first started getting that feeling, the numerology didn't even dawn on me. Like when you add up the numbers of the year, it's a 9, and nine is about bringing things to completion, or like you said, stabilization. And ironically enough, Trump is also a 9. I do believe he's like the 45th president or something. So 4 + 5 = 9, completion. Not to say that he's going to be a savior or anything, but just symbolically representing maybe that completion point where we start to look at the idea of, okay, maybe we should bring this old paradigm to an end. And, you know, the idea that, like, what Buckminster Fuller once said, that you don't create the new by fighting the old. The mm-hmm. way you do it is by making the old obsolete. Like, you know, the 2016 Lamborghini Diablo did not have a fierce battle with Henry Ford's Model T, and that, you know, just won one out over the other. It's just a process that as you keep improving things, over time, the things that are better and more efficient become more widely accepted. And what is less efficient becomes obsolete eventually. And yeah, there's resistance at first. Like when electricity was first created, there was huge resistance against it. Some mm-hmm. people thought it was just not needed. Like, oh, what do you need electricity for? Look at everything I already have. It already serves me just fine. Electricity is an unnecessary luxury. Who would even need it? Then there's the idea of, oh, electricity is from Satan. It's demonic. It's from the devil. It's this unseen energy that makes things happen. So that can only come from Satan. And there's all these crazy ideas about electricity before it got accepted. So there was some opposition, just like there was opposition to cars in the beginning. like, you know, you've got a horse and a buggy and you've got 2 feet, you've got bicycles, and why do you need anything more than that? More than that is too excessive. So it's like all good new things always have this resistance from some people because they want to remain stuck in their sameness. But as these things persist and become more widely accepted, then the old thing becomes obsolete and no longer used. So when it comes to the various, you know, mechanisms of tyranny, both the internal mind prison and, you know, as above, so below, out in the greater world stage as well, I think the more people, move into a mindset of curiosity and creativity and innovation and making things better, rather than this control freaky trying to hold on to things and fight other things, and that domineering, you know, sort of I'm justified my way, wah 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 sort of drive. I think that we're going to start seeing things get better and better. Also, we also have to understand that, you know, even though a lot of the, you know, rich psychopaths who give no fuck about anybody, even though on one aspect they want to fit in with, you know, their buddies at their level and go along with Agenda 21 and all these other game plans, first and foremost, they are out for themselves. And that has actually led to some ironically unexpected positive things, because they want to make money in their industries, and a lot of them are starting to learn that helping people makes more money than fucking them. And they're starting to see this, and they're thinking, oh, if everybody else is in this mindset of fucking people, but I know that helping the people is better and makes more money faster, then I can totally just kick all my competition's ass, because right now I'm the only one seeing the light about that. So I'm going to be able to have that competitive edge and make more money faster. And also, like, you know, there's a lot of dangerous elements, you know, about the curly light bulbs in so many ways that they're unsafe, but, you know, that's done on purpose as per Agenda 21. So you would think that the powers that be wouldn't allow something as safe and awesomely efficient as the new LED light bulbs, but that is being allowed out because, you know, somebody up there is saying, hey, I like personal profits better than I like going according to the agenda of my peers. So I'm going to go and I'm going to make more money than them and have that competitive edge. So a negative greed aspect is actually starting to have a positive effect. The more a lot of these, you know, greedy rich people that used to make their money by fucking people over are starting to see, you know, helping people out actually makes more money. Doing things fairly, making things of good quality, embracing more innovation, you know, that actually makes more money. And if I do this, I'll be able to minimize my expenses, maximize my profits, and, you know, totally have my own little empire. So nothing's ever just black or white. There's always shades of gray. This is one of those weird shades where something inherently negative can morph into something that's very positive.
Yeah, as happens in many instances, many cases. It's Adam Smith talked about the invisible hand that moves the market. And I feel like there's an invisible hand in ethics as well, because whenever you get money involved, there is definitely that that desire to outperform your peers, as you were saying. And this is really what makes the market work the way that it does. So it's fascinating to watch it.
Yeah, because we're starting to move out of that idea of having a disposable society making money on things breaking and fucking people over into new paradigms. Because what a lot of people don't realize as well, like, you know, a lot of these older industries feel threatened by the new ones, and they're thinking, oh, well, if my current industry becomes obsolete, then there's going to be money lost, jobs lost, it's going to damage the economy, it's going to create chaos. So we need to fight against the new to maintain our current stability. And what they don't realize is that for every new industry that opens up, millions of jobs open up with it. And, you know, millions of new opportunities for, rich people to get even richer off of these new industries. And the only reason people, feel threatened by, oh my God, these illegal immigrants are taking our jobs, or, oh, machine automation is putting people out of work and this and that and the other. The only reason that sort of thing is actually even able to happen is because of the technological ceiling that's been put in place by captains of industries that actually fear expansion, that fear innovation, that think that that's their enemy, that they need to maintain these obsolete ways of doing things. Otherwise, the new is going to destroy the old, and then where will they be? Another part of it is that if a lot of these people are at the top of their game and they're in first place, they don't want to end up in 10th place, 20th place, 30th place. For them, it's not as much about the money as it is the power and influence. So if they're no longer top dog, then they're worried about their power and their influence and their control that they have over the ebb and flow of things. And they're thinking, oh, well, if other people rise higher than me, then I'm not going to be able to have as much control as I had. And if I can't have that, then my preferred lifestyle won't be able to be sustained the way I like it. And then, oh, whatever shall I do? They don't really realize that it doesn't matter if you're the top dog or not, as long as you're doing what you need to do for your own continuity. And that if you want to continue to expand and increase that continuity, you have to be more open-minded to new industries and new opportunities and new technologies, instead of working off of the old dysfunctional, disposable society method. Because even if you were to make a product that's not only cheap to make, but will last decades, centuries, maybe even, if you make it well enough, you're not going to lose money on it, because there's always going to be so many new products for so many things as innovation unfolds and new ideas unfold, that there's never going to be a shortage of anything to sell and never a shortage of anybody to buy if they keep that expansion going. But in a disposable society where we're not recycling much, we're creating garbage and we're operating under a system of everything breaking, there's not really, much room for that expansion. So it's kind of put it in this finite, inflexible area that cannot be sustained. That if we keep trying to stay here, civilization can and will collapse if we don't allow for that expansion. So I think a lot more people are realizing this now and are starting to, be more willing to allow for that expansion. And I think that's also a part of that integration process as well. We're finally starting to realize it's slow, it's not as fast as we want it to be, but it's faster than most people think it would be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the role of technology has really assisted that integration. Specifically, the role of the internet, insofar as it's allowed people from disparate backgrounds to communicate with each other. There's a there's a chapter in The Grapes of Wrath where John Steinbeck is talking about how all of the various characters are all sitting in their own settings, all alone, thinking that this is happening to them. And The Grapes of Wrath is about the Dust Bowl and about the Depression and about things which are bad, which are happening to people. And it's very interesting because, pre the internet, that's precisely what people would do. They would operate with the limited information available to them. And everybody pretty much thought they were having their own experience and that they were having their experience alone, when in fact it was a collective experience. And the internet is magnifying the fact that it's a collective experience.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really assisting with integration, because it's a hell of a lot easier to integrate when you realize that there are millions of people just like you going through the same stuff, and you can talk to them and connect to them and reach out to them and learn from them and have them learn from you.
Yeah, and everything is, of course, a double-edged sword. I mean, the internet has brought just as much petty bickering as it has people coming together in understanding. And, you know, when we see both, we start to realize that which one we do is our choice. It's not anything being forced on us. And that if we choose to go more in the direction of being understanding and empathetic while still standing in our sovereignty, I don't mean letting everybody, like, you know, fuck you over and whatever and be a doormat and whatever else, but, you know, being willing to, at the very least, understanding where someone is coming from who you strongly disagree with, instead of attacking them and saying, no, you're wrong and I'm right, fuck you, and you mean all like this
experience? Yeah.
But, you know, it's like within that, like, then what we find out is that when we stand in that sovereignty, but at the same time having no desire to fight with everybody, then most of the people who want to fight with us get very bored with us very quickly. We become very insufferable to them. I refer to this as benevolent trolling, of course, or, you know, killing them with kindness is another way of putting it. But kindness, not even necessarily in that Disney sort of, oh, I love you sort of way. I mean, sometimes, you know, kindness is dished out with a hammer. It's not all flowers. But when I refer to kindness, I just mean, you know, being willing to have that understanding and that respect for somebody else's position, even if you don't agree with them, and even if you think that person is scummy, to have that understanding and respect so that you don't feel the need to try to dominate them and force them to your will, when you can respect that it's okay if they don't like you or don't resonate with you or they think you're a scumbag or whatever it is that they might think, no matter how negative, that you could just sit there like, all right, well, I obviously don't agree with you, but, you know, that's your right to think that. And I happen to be an advocate of liberty and freedom, and freedom is the right to someone to say what you don't like, don't want, don't think. Otherwise, what then is freedom? So once you get into that mode, the people who are addicted to the bickering and the back and forth, they don't even want to deal with you. And you start to get a reputation among those people too, which helps you as well. Because your reputation among those people becomes, oh, well, Dave Kelso is insufferable, you know. So don't even bother dealing with him. Just shun him completely because he's insufferable, because he thinks this, and this, and he's not willing to fight. He's not willing to go at it with us. He's not willing to try to let us dominate him or to try to dominate us. He's not willing to have that war. So he's the lowest of the low. Don't even waste your time. And then getting that reputation among that type of groups of people mean, if those groups stay away from you, that means you're at peace, there's no drama. And the only people who can approach you are of the more open-minded variety. That doesn't necessarily mean everyone within that variety is going to get along with you, but it, at the very least, it means that you're going to have few, if any, of those people that are like actively wanting to fuck with other people. They might be going through their own paradigms, so you might have your collisions with them and whatever, but they're not like actively out to, like, you know, battle you and have this big heated whatever. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean. Yeah, the people. You know, Katerina and I refer to it as, like, people vibrate right out of your reality.
Mm-hmm.
Things will as well. I recall that I walked into a store the other day, and there was this homeless person, like, right sitting right outside the store, just yelling and screaming and swearing at everybody who was passing by. I did not notice this person, and not because I didn't have compassion for them, but just because people who yell and scream and swear at me are so far outside of my reality that I just don't notice that they exist. The only reason I noticed this person existed is because everybody around me was acting all butthurt. And finally I looked around and I'm like, oh, and this person's screaming obscenities at me. I guess if I was in a place where I would be butthurt by somebody screaming obscenities for me, then this person would have appeared in my reality. But they just didn't.
I'd probably have noticed, but just found it funny. Just laughed. Just been like, man, you know, just some people aren't happy unless they just aren't happy.
Right. Like, okay, well, best of luck with the obscenity screaming. I mean, hopefully that gets you a job or whatever.
Yeah. I probably would have, like, whipped out my camera, instant PSEC episode. Like, This is a tutorial as to how to not apply for employment at a grocery store.
That's a fact. There you go. I thought it was amazing because, you know, I find that, you know, there are definitely people who are crazy makers in my life, mm-hmm. and in Katerina's life, but we find that they're very much satellites. They're kind of like orbiting at a distance. Just mm-hmm. every now and then they kind of make their presence known, but we never engage. Mm-hmm. They just go along their merry way. They're just looking for somebody to engage with. Just don't
engage. Yeah, and you don't have the receiver dish at the bottom, so you're not locked on.
Right. Not locked onto that.
So they get to deal with those who are locked on.
Right, and more power to them, because honestly, in a perverse way, they really enjoy doing that to each other.
Yeah.
So, you know what? Like, let them have their joy. Who am I to rob them of their joy of being miserable?
Yeah, that's what they want.
That's what they want. They can have it.
Yeah, because really, if you look at it, it's like, what right do I have to try to tell them that they can't have that, you know? Then that would be doing the thing that I'm saying shouldn't be done, and that would just make me an instant hypocrite.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. So therefore, if they want to have that, and if that's the thing that they desire, well, then go have it, and have it with my blessing. But have it with somebody else who wants to have it with you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the way I used to be a long time ago, it's like, I think we all had our moments where we used to dive into that kind of stuff. I mean, just the way society is, but these days it's really uninteresting. Like, unless something is like really over the top, like some of these social justice warriors that I can't help but like bust out laughing at because it's hilarious. It's like South Park becomes real or something. It's just over the top. Like, save for something that extreme, you know, I just look at this other shit. It's like, it's really pointless. It's like, I really have no desire to have any involvement. It's like, I see it, you know, scroll through as just a brief mention or whatever, something going on. I'm just like, yeah, well, that's interesting. And just whatever. And I'm just moving on by it because I don't really care to get wrapped up in it. Sometimes there are things that jump out that are just extremely hilarious. And like, I'll point those out because it's funny, you know. I mean, paradigm shift in educational comedy, right? I mean, why not laugh at stuff? But I really have no interest in directly interacting, you know, within all these dramas and stuff. And it's like, and you know, petitions too. Like, I think that the purpose of a petition is for everybody to let each other know that they are on the same page when it comes to a certain point of view. But other than that, they serve no purpose, because what? You're going to petition the shark to not eat you? Really? Like that's going to work? Well, if we get enough signatures from the tuna, the shark will be forced to change its mind. No. The shark's still going to do what the shark's going to do, because it's a shark, and that's mm-hmm. what the shark does. And no amount of signatures on a petition is going to change that. That's also what the people in the Occupy movements didn't realize as well. It's like, if you're out there trying to bring awareness to the rest of the people around you that problems exist, fine. But if you're trying to, you know, to confront the fat cats on Wall Street and the dirty politicians and say, we demand that you change because we're out here in droves demanding it, all that tells the politicians and the Wall Street fat cats, they're laughing like, okay, we have them right where we want them, because they're showing us that they're not willing to make a move without us doing anything. They still expect us to do it for them. They refuse to do anything for themselves. They're just like a bunch of screaming five-year-olds going, mommy, daddy, we want you to do this, and we're going to cry and hold our breath until you do it. And so they're just showing them that, you know, just these psychopathic fat cats, they're looking at them like, okay, well, they're right where we want them. They're not going to take their sovereignty. They're like little children making demands of dysfunctional parents. So we're just still going to do whatever we want, regardless of what they demand, because they're showing us they're not willing to actually do anything.
I feel like a petition is like a social permission slip to not do anything else except come out against a problem, you know, intellectually. It's a
it's a way of saying, oh, I stand against this thing so fervently that I'll sign the paper, but not actually do anything else.
Yeah.
And because there's 10,000 of us, then surely this must have some effect.
Yeah, but it has none.
It has none at all.
The only effect it has is letting more people know just how many people feel, you know, about a particular topic. But other than that, it doesn't actually do anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can bet that Standing Rock is still happening and that all the people who signed, signed petitions are not aware of it.
Yeah, I mean, as a matter of fact, the only thing that really seems to work in that regard, and kind of thinking back to the Matrix movies where it was said that the machines have to obey the rules of their own matrix, that they too are locked, you know, within that structure. We vote with our dollars, not at the polls. So if you don't like something a corporation is doing, withdraw your funding from that corporation, because that corporation doesn't survive on hugs and kisses and good intentions and whatever. That corporation survives on money that it needs for funding to continue its operations. As a matter of fact, there's been so much boycotting of GMOs that Monsanto ended up redlining so bad that Bayer had to actually buy Monsanto. Mm-hmm. In order to keep Monsanto afloat, because people were voting with their dollars. People were saying, hey, we're not going to buy these products. And just like how Tropicana orange juice just went, you know, recently went non-GMO, because not only were a lot of people in the United States not buying Tropicana because they were GMO and too many people didn't want the GMO, but most other countries in the world will not buy GMO. There's a global boycott on GMO in most countries. So Tropicana is like, shit, if we're not able to sell to what we need for profit margins locally, and we're not hardly able to sell internationally, we're going to go broke if we don't do something about this. Mm-hmm. So the only thing they could do is stop doing the GMO shit so that people would start buying from them.
It's the only language that business understands is money, and money is a social construct anyways, so it really has no importance except that which we ascribe to it.
Yeah, and like all the people who are trying to boycott the DAPL pipeline and all that, you know, if they really wanted to do something helpful towards that, all they'd have to do is buy a gallon or two less of gas per week than they normally would. And when you multiply that by 100 million plus drivers, mm-hmm. you know, that sends a financial message, because the oil companies see that they just took a sharp drop in their profits.
Yep.
And when you then equate that as a form of protest about the pipeline, then the oil corporations might be like, shit, well, maybe we don't want to go fucking with these people, because maybe they'll start boycotting even more.
Yep.
So, yeah, there's so much gas money that gets spent just on, you know, people feeling too lazy to walk to the store that's two blocks away to get their couple items, or, you know, going out instead of ordering in, or whatever the case may be. There's so many things that they spend gas money on that don't absolutely need to be spent on. And those are the things that they can cut back on, you know, for their boycott. They don't have to cut back on going to work, you know, right. But they can cut back on the extra shit that they normally spend on and go, well, you know, maybe I'll do something different. Maybe I'll walk my ass two blocks over to that store, or I'll order pizza in, because that pizza delivery guy is going to be out there anyway servicing people. So instead of him and me being out there, it'll be just right. him.
It's just him. Mm-hmm. Yep, pretty much. And with alternative technologies and transportation becoming so much more prevalent, you know that electric motorcycles now have a similar range to gasoline-powered motorcycles, but are otherwise superior to every way.
Oh, like, yeah, well, just like the one, just like the one PSEC episode with you and Katerina in the Tesla, it had better acceleration than a gas vehicle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, by orders of magnitude. I mean, I've never been in a gas vehicle that accelerated like that one does. And they've just made it faster over the years, and they've just made it go further.
Yeah.
They've just made them more reliable. And to the point where, like, I am now very seriously considering that I don't even want to own a gasoline motorcycle. I want to own an electric one. I don't even want to own a gasoline car. I'll own an electric car. I live on Maui. I don't need range. Where are you going to go? It's Maui.
Yeah, and then, like, here in Chicago, on the sides of all the buses, like, they made it a point to advertise that the buses are hybrid gas electric now.
Okay.
So, you know, they've got the hybridization going, so they're not using as much gas.
Yep. Yeah. And, you know, with automatic driving cars, which are coming, you know, give it 3 years. We're going to see auto drivers on the road. They're going to use less gas too, because you're not going to have people with a lead foot. You're going to have people who push the button, and the car will most efficiently drive itself to where it needs to go.
Yeah. You're probably going to start to have special lanes going for that, you know, have under and overpasses that go above and below the normal traffic, so they don't even need stoplights or anything because the cars are auto driven. So you're right. not going to have car accidents.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be amazing. And just in the next 5 years or so, in transportation specifically, right? And as you were saying before, old industries cling to their old paradigms. The oil industry is obviously in bed with the automaking industry, which is, they're all repurposing themselves as energy companies, but they're still fighting for their old model, for their old paradigm.
Yeah.
Really, that's what allows Elon Musk to do what he does. That's the only reason we have a Tesla, is because GM literally, like, they had electric cars in the 90s. They crushed them.
Yeah, and then look at, like, the one maglev train that you were on in China that I'm damn sure is electric, that is not gas, and that thing goes like 300 miles per hour.
Yeah, that was impressive. Yeah, that thing does. It goes 300. Yeah, I've gone 300 miles an hour on a train. Neato. I'd forgotten about that.
Oh, you have, huh? I mean, hell, I can.
My life is like full of interesting shit.
I can actually, if you just give me a moment, I can actually,
play the PSEC.
I can pull that footage up. I can actually go straight to it. I mean, I'm only going to play the section with the train, but the full episode for, you know, the people watching this one, is on scrolling down to it.
Paul Shanghai Adventure, I believe.
Yeah. Yes, I know. I'm looking for the full. Yeah, what was that, 2015? Trying to find whether or not that was 2015 or 2016. Maybe that was that 2016?
Yeah, that was 2016.
Yeah, there it is. I mean, we've been doing, you know, I've had PSEC since 2011, so this is the seventh year, so, like, after a while, you start to, like, think, huh, what year was that one anyway? PSEC 2016 calls Shanghai Adventure. One sec, I'm just going to load it up and then jump to the...
Yeah, it will be near the end.
The train part.
Yeah, I had the Shanghai train near the end.
I know where it is.
Okay, well, yeah, you cut the whole video together, I think.
Yep. Hold on. Okay, yeah, I'm going to disengage my headphones, and I'm going to engage screen share. You can see this, right?
I can.
And on the way out, I figured I would do at least one touristy thing. So instead of having my driver drop me off at the airport, I have him drop me off at the maglev station. So here's that fun adventure.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm looking forward to going on a maglev. I know how they work. I haven't been on them. Maglev track. The Shanghai maglev is taking over to the airport. Hopefully, it goes really fast. All right, we're riding the maglev train out of the station. It's as smooth as expected. Let's see how fast this sucker goes.
And I also did an extreme slow motion replay.
Right
along, about 50 kilometers an hour. Chicago needs trains like this.
On this side, there will be another train. 100 kilometers an hour. Supposing this train goes by so fast, it's over a lake, in a blink. It's like we're holding steady at 300 kilometers an hour. So it's about a 7-minute ride, about 3.5 minutes, and we should pass the other train. I've heard that it's a professional experience, so I'm really excited about it. What a neat way to end my trip to Shanghai.
This would have been a 30 to 40 minute drive, my driver tells me. Chicago needs that. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, I love that slow motion section. You could still read like the letters and numbers on the track and shit.
Yeah. I mean, with the iPhone catches about 60 frames a second or so. So each one of those frames was 1/60th of a second. It was quite badass.
Yeah, so like I took that and just, you know, that section, I just put it into extreme slow motion, and you could just see like all the really good clear detail that you couldn't see at the regular speed.
Another way in which technology makes our lives better. I have a slow motion camera on my phone that just is in my pocket and also makes phone calls.
Yeah, and I mean, the only thing preventing that sort of technology from going up in more cities, again, is just too many people trying to cling on to obsolete industry and not allowing for expansion. They've also got, you know, they've had the technology for a while for maglev trains that could go like, you know, Mach 4, that, you know, you could work in San Francisco and, you know, take your lunch break in Chicago, like insane. And
I actually heard something about somewhere in Japan, they started building a prototype finally and are wanting to test that technology. I mean, I'm sure it probably just goes in a big circle or something. It's not like a full deployment. It's just a prototype. But basically, the reason that maglev can go so fast is because it's actually hovering in the middle of a tube, just, you know, via electromagnetism. So there's really no friction.
Right. Yeah. Elon Musk is actually proposing something very similar, except it uses vacuum instead of magnets. It levitates off the track with magnets, but it actually uses vacuum to suck it from one place to another. It's an interesting concept. We'll see where it goes. I think the guy is more concerned right now with colonizing Mars, so he's got slightly dry.
Yeah, so, I mean, well, he may or may not realize that he's never gonna colonize anything off of this planet until this planet does some major shifts with its paradigms about a lot of things, because there's too much politics, bureaucracy, money issues, etc., that would prevent him from doing it. So, like, even if he had all the right technology on the drawing board and it was totally possible to do, all the bureaucracy and all the other issues are just going to shut him down in 2 seconds. It's just going to be like, nope, sorry, can't.
Yep. And then when humanity is ready, they'll go do it. I mean,
yeah,
we've had technology for a long time, and really we just need consciousness to expand to the point where we're actually willing to use it. Yeah.
I mean, when you got too many paradigms in the way, you know, something that in a more benevolent society and more efficient society would cost, you know, $1 million to manufacture, then costs like $100 trillion just because bureaucracy and stupidity and everything else. And, you know, on that sort of the scale, you cannot fund any sort of Mars colonization because it would take more money than Earth actually has. So it's just like, you're not going to do it.
Yeah, a bit of a hard limit there.
Yeah, totally. Where's Katerina?
Right here.
She's right over there.
Oh, yeah.
She's listening, but not necessarily contributing. But here, let me put the spotlight on her.
So what else do you want to say about all this stuff and your thoughts on this year and
came up on my news feed. It says, be thankful for every heartbreak, for they were planned. They come into your life to reveal another layer of yourself to you and then leave. Their purpose is to shake you up, tear apart your ego a little bit, show you your obstacles and addictions, break your heart open so new light can get in, make you so desperate and out of control that you have to transform your life, and you do. Paradigm shitting.
Interesting.
It was kind of relevant for me.
Everybody totally fears heartbreak, fears betrayal. As a matter of fact,
heartbreak. I'm not talking
the other day.
Relationship though, heartbreak.
I know.
Anytime.
I know. Anything. I understand. I know. I was just going to say that the other day, Kristen brought up something that Gangaji had said in a video that I'm paraphrasing, but you know, we tend to try to run from and avoid heartbreak you know, so much that our hearts just get broken by default of trying to run away from it, that we,
yeah, you told me that
we're doing the opposite of what we're intending. Instead of avoiding heartbreak, we're setting ourselves up for it in the act of trying to avoid it, instead of looking at the idea of heartbreak as, you know, just another learning lesson. If we just saw it as just another learning lesson, it wouldn't happen nearly as often. But if we're viewing it as the enemy, then it's a problem. Just like what Gangaji said, suffering is created from. Suffering is the always trying to run from pain and run towards pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas both are going to happen. That's inevitable. And if you embrace both instead of running towards one and away from the other, then there wouldn't be all the suffering.
because the suffering is always in the running, having that terrifying monster always, you know, feeling like it's always chasing you, and at the same time running towards pleasure so much, feeling as if no matter what you do, it's not good enough. Oh, it's not obtainable because I'm so busy running away from this monster over here that no matter how much I run towards pleasure, no matter how much I run towards what I want, I just can't. It's just not obtainable. Because the only place we could do anything is in the now. And if we're 50% focused in the past and 50% focused in the future, regret of the past, worrying about the future, then what are we doing in the now? Nothing. Mm-hmm. Suffering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I totally see that.
Anything else you want to add on these points?
No, that was my contribution.
Other than seeing me this summer, what are you looking forward to with 2017?
I just think this year, I'm looking forward to more connection with people. Like I'm having people reach out to me like already, just in this really unity consciousness kind of way. Like I had someone reach out to me tonight, like in all seriousness, asking me if I've ever thought about Jehovah's Witnesses, and like, but like she made really good points about consciousness and like, you know, for her, like she's been reading the Bible and stuff, and she's also a person who's been like in this new awareness, new consciousness kind of movement of, you know, I don't really like calling it new age, but like, you know, new paradigm thought, you know, so expanding the mind and thinking for oneself. And she also is like me in the sense that she's been revisiting the Bible and really learning from it and really gaining knowledge and understanding from it when previously her mind was closed to it and mm-hmm. was not interested in learning from it, the book, because she just wrote it all off as nonsense and then just would seek spiritual teaching from every other place except the Bible, you know, thinking she was being all unity consciousness and love and light, you know, not like embracing of everything while still having this blind spot, you know, and that was me too.
Even General Patton won a lot of his battles through biblical influence. He would look to the Bible for inspiration and form workable battle strategies. Not that I'm advocating war, but just saying it happens.
Yeah, well, I get it. Like I am also applying biblical knowledge in my life and seeing the effects it's having, like on me personally. Like honestly, if you want to talk about sovereignty, look to Jesus. Jesus teaches sovereignty in ways that New Agers could not even understand.
Like, yeah, totally.
Like, could not even understand. And it's just like this level of personal power, like it's all of it, like the biblical knowledge is influencing me as well and really empowering me in these new ways to really speak my truth more and to not be afraid and to really not be afraid and to really just trust that I'm okay and that if God is for us, who can be against us kind of stuff, you know, it's really emboldening me. And I feel like that is what I'm most looking forward to in 2017 is just being able to have more of these open-hearted conversations with people, to be able to really relate and be human with each other rather than having all of the fucking masks on. And all pretenses and all of the whatever uppity bullshit that happens as a result of all of these ego paradigms that have been in the way. Like I'm so enjoying how much more soulful connection I can have with people these days. It's so enjoyable and refreshing.
Yeah, totally. And 2017, it's just like, this is just perfect year with perfect timing. Like, you know, PSEC just joined CCN.
Yeah, that'll be really fun.
Yeah, Tuesday, January 10th, 4 p.m. Central, 10 p.m. GMT, you know, CCN.media. people will be able to check that out. And I've already got a PSEC episode explaining what's all up with that, so I'm not going to go into that here. If anybody wants to know that's watching this now, they can go watch the other one. But I just thought that, you know, the timing was really cool that it's happening for 2017, and it really is all about that integration and expansion sort of thing, and a willingness for, you know, for people to really put things together and to learn and to grow and to expand and all of that, and instead of, you know, the whole dick wag. It's like, you know, first in the beginning there was, you know, one plus decades ago, there was, you know, the so-called fringe nuts, truthers, this and that. They were the extreme minority. They started real small. They grew to a certain point of awareness, but they still have, you know, the dickwag ego thing going on, but they still triumphed a lot over the older mainstream paradigm that was previous. And now it looks like, you know, there's another group of people that isn't, that it's not about an idea of, oh, we need a movement, or we need this group or that protocol or this new strategy or whatever, but it's more like a growing awareness in people about exactly all the things, you know, we've already discussed on this hangout, and who are really just as sick of all the left-right paradigm dick-wagging, just as sick of that as the truth movement has ever been sick of, you know, the mainstream bullshit. And it's like the truth movement was like the first step, like, you know, like birth to, you know, 1.5 or something, and now we're at the stage of like getting rid of the diapers and putting on the big boy pants, and, you know, and moving into that, and then soon humanity will hit puberty, so to speak, and et cetera, et cetera. You know, I mean, it just kind of looks like it's just this unfolding.
Mm-hmm.
That it's just going into stages of unfolding, and people like you and me and, you know, Melanie Vermeer and Richard and et cetera, are just, you know, a part of this, you know, this next experience that people are having, where we're looking around and going, all right, well, you know, the truth movement did so much and all that, but it's time to be more about truth. It's time to be more than just, oh, here's this data, believe what I say, don't believe what they say. To move beyond that and really take personal responsibility in who we are as a person and how we act and how we treat each other, and really making some decisions of how we want to live life instead of just how we want to discuss life. You know, topics are all well and wonderful, but how are we living our lives?
Totally. Yeah, it's so much more about the practical application, and I'm happy about that, because, you know, you and I have had a lot of practice at practical application. And so I feel like you and I have been preparing for this, and, you know, it's perfect that we're like now on CCN and stuff, because I feel like our wealth, our treasure trove of experience will now really equip us well to be able to speak about this from an intelligible place.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's just going to be a really great, a great catalyst, and not the only one. I mean, you know, you got Max Egan out there doing his thing, and he, you know, he's been speaking on these ideas, you know, well before now. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, though they like a lot of stuff of what he says, they just look at him kind of weird. They can't get their minds fully around this whole, like, wait a minute, we don't have to dickwag with each other, you know, kind of concept. And a lot of them just haven't been able to process that part of what Max is saying.
Right.
And now I think we're starting to move into a time where more people are going to be able to process that part of it and just be like, oh yeah, that does make more sense. If we actually walk our talk instead of just talking our talk, and our motivations are being the best person we could be instead of shoving our view down everyone's throats, then that will get us going more to where we're wanting to go, instead of remaining stuck in the same ruts. Because the truth movement's looking around like, okay, we've been doing all this truth telling, but there hasn't been as much active
change or practical application as we would like. And they look at it and go, oh, well, is humanity lost? Is humanity hopeless? We've talked and talked and talked and talked, and not much has gotten done. It's like, well, yeah, if everybody's just talking and no one's willing to do, then what the fuck do you expect? Start doing.
Doing like how?
Doing and being the change instead of just talking about, oh, Federal Reserve Bank and Illuminati and fractional reserve banking and Ponzi schemes and corruption here and pedophilia there. It's like, it's all well and good and fine to, you know, get all this information out and make people aware. That's all well and great. But like, what are people actually doing and being in their own lives to actually create positive change? You know, are they being the type of person that they want? No, they're angrily arguing with people and arguing with their fellow truthers and, you know, it's saying nasty things like, you know, one person is hooked on one piece of information as one piece of the puzzle. Somebody else gets another piece, but instead of them realizing they each have a piece of the puzzle, each of them think they have the whole picture. So then they start calling each other government shills and deceptions and psyops and, oh, this person's bad and that person's trying to deceive you. And so instead of working together, you know, they do it exactly what... Like, you know, they talk about how the elites use divide and conquer strategy. It's like, well, duh, it's still working on you fucking people. You know, you think you're awake, but you're not. You're aware, but, you know, you're not really awake because you don't have any freaking compassion and you're still falling for the same old games. Mm-hmm. Because if you have compassion, you're not going to fall for the same old games. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are waking up into that. Just like similarly, that one person that you just mentioned woke up, you know, out of the idea that, oh, I guess all this lovey-lighty shit isn't all there is to it. And I mean, yeah, the lovey-lighty stuff has its merit and value and up to a point. It's correct up to a point, but there's more than that. Mm-hmm. And if you limit yourself to just that, you're going to be pretty useless because there's all this other data and all this other means of applying yourself that, you know, that you're rejecting. And right. So the same thing with the truth movement. They're so caught in their little bubbles and so intolerant of anybody else's point of view that they all end up fighting each other, and that's what the psychopaths want us to do anyway. So whether you're talking, and you know, and I mean, even within subsections of the lovey-lighty community, it's the same thing. All these different people in narcissistic bubbles fighting with each other. Like, look at what happened, you know, between Teal Swan and Jordan LaButthurt. And Jordan was like, oh, Teal is a MK Ultra government agent, blah, blah. It's like, really, dude? Really? Like, that is all love and light? That is fucking spiritual? Fucking lashing out at your peers and saying that they work for the government? Whatever, dude.
Yeah, that's a tough
thing. He put all this energy into this big dick wag with Teal. And he was ignoring the shit out of us because we were making too many good points. That would be PSEC 2015, information is just information. Or maybe that was 2014. Pretty sure it was 2015, though. But anyway, yeah, that was that one, and it was totally hilarious. We were all just getting ignored out of existence because we were making good points on there. And Jordan was just, you know, just in this whole dickwag thing. And, you know, Jordan's married to... or married or boyfriend or whatever the hell he is, the significant other of Leah Tarunin. And I think he's more than just a little bit of a control freak and a narcissist because he's up there saying, my way's the only way. Everybody else works for the government. And I'm just like, whatever. But a lot of people get like that in the spiritual movement. So, I mean, that's just an example. I'm not trying to single him out or anything. But that's just one of many jillion freaking examples out there. And, you know, all these different people in groups, they have the same objective, love and light, make the world better and positivity. But they focus more on fighting each other and being suspicious and worried and, oh, I have to protect myself against the dark entities. Ooh, protection, fear. And it's just like, if you're in that state of fear and in that narcissistic bubble, then what good are you going to be? Then you're just doing the opposite of what you're intending.
So I think a lot of people are starting to realize, hey, if you remain stuck in a bubble, whether it's a new agey bubble or a truther bubble or pick your bubble, fundamentalist Christian bubble, fundamentalist Muslim bubble, fundamentalist anything bubble, whatever the fuck it is, that you're really, really limiting yourself and limiting your impact.
Yeah, and like I think fundamentalist Christians get such a bad rap because, I mean, I know that there can be people who are technically a fundamentalist Christian who do not act in the typical stereotype of what we're deeming as fundamentalist Christian and hateful and vengeful and spiteful and mean and nasty. Like, you know, that's also a judgment. That's also a sweeping generalization of all people in a group. So it's like, you know, I think the more that all of us can start to pull back the definitions and the layers and the perceptions we have of all different types of people and stop judging everybody by their cover and to stop, like, really, you know, just broad brushing everybody, you know, people of all groups, like Muslims and terrorists and blah, blah, blah.
I think that fundamentalist extremists are the extreme minority of any group, but they have such big mouths and the silent majority don't stick up for themselves that people are just under the impression that this tiny little bitty micro group speaks for the larger whole when they don't. But unfortunately, the larger whole is letting them do it because they won't speak up and say, hey, that view doesn't represent us.
Exactly.
So, like, you know, I'll even tell Muslims, like, you know, don't be so surprised that a lot of non-Muslims hate you and are scared of you because you've got these radical idiots doing jihads and whatever and saying all this crazy shit. And where are you speaking up against it? Where is your voice? You're too locked into a state of fear and you don't want to speak up, but you're the majority. There's like, at most, probably like a million, and that's probably even too high of a figure, a million dangerous, crazy, wacko Muslims, and the rest of the Muslims, which are like almost a billion or whatever, those are just the ones that want to be left the hell alone and live in peace like everybody else. So if that 99.9% majority would just speak up and say, hey, see those crazies over there? They don't represent us. Then, you know, things would roll a bit differently. But if you don't stand up and be heard, don't stand up and cast your vote in that way and say, hey, this is my sovereignty. I stand in solidarity. If you don't do that, then the high school gossip factor kicks in and just everybody of different groups believes that because these minority of wackos are speaking up but no one else is, that they represent the majority, and then you get stereotyped.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yep. So that's why I also do as much speaking up as I can for myself and just say, hey, you know, I might agree with some things different groups say and disagree with other aspects and whatever, but, you know, I'm just me and nobody represents me but me, and I don't have wacko nutcases representing me. I speak for myself. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Yep. I'm getting practiced at that myself.
Yep. We're learning. We're all learning. None of us have this down perfect.
My battery is about to die.
I can see that. The power of your hotness. The computer cannot handle it. Yeah. So you were talking.
Well, shouldn't the power of her hotness then actually be charging the battery?
You would think. I mean, if only I could figure out a way to harness Katerina's hotness, we could solve all world energy.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. I'm working on it. I'm working on harnessing her hotness. I feel like...
Why am I hot, Paul?
Well, so that we could convert your hotness into electrical energy.
I'm just asking why you think I'm hot.
Because your butt is very lay down onable.
So he thinks I'm hot just because of my body, apparently.
Mm-hmm. Only because of your body, because I'm shallow.
Yeah, only because of my body. He's shallow.
This is why we've had a really fulfilling relationship for a long period of time is because I'm actually shallow, but I've hidden it pretty well.
Yeah, he'd sell you as a piece of art, but that would be illegal.
Yeah, I mean, when she wants a gallery, like clientele,
Oh yeah.
For the viewing audience, this is pure sarcasm, just in case anyone who is sarcasm illiterate might be watching.
Were you sarcastic about the people coming into the gallery?
No.
That wasn't sarcastic.
I was being sarcastic.
Well, I mean acting as if you're nothing more than a sex object. That's what he's being sarcastic about.
Oh yeah, exactly. Totally. We make jokes about this all the time. Right. We actually really love and respect each other.
Yeah, she's nothing more than a sex object, but only between the hours of like 10 p.m. and 4 a.m.
Yeah.
And sometimes in the afternoon. Sometimes like
afternoon
between 12
delight.
And 1. But other than that, she's like a totally respected member of the household.
So basically you're saying there are hours where you get to disrespect her.
With my consent.
There's no disrespect.
No disrespect happening.
No.
So Paul, is there anything else you want to add to anything that has been discussed so far? Any other thoughts you want to get in? I know there's something other than a thought you'd like to get into Katerina, but that's besides the point.
Into a mood where it's definitely does not benefit me to continue doing a PSEC episode.
Now we can finish the PSEC episode.
We totally can. Yeah.
We don't have to stiff Dave like that.
I feel like to conclude the point that you were talking about with regard to integration, I believe that people finding their voice, specifically people of various religious groups, I mean, like, I talk about my Christianity. I never talked about my Christianity before, but
I share it
on the internet now because, like, if other people can say what they believe, why can't I say what I believe? And my voice gets to say that the Westboro Baptist folks who are out there saying God hates fags are a bunch of idiots who don't represent what Christ actually has to say.
Yeah.
And so if I'm silent, if I don't actually render an opinion on that, then you would be perfectly legitimate in assuming that I have the same exact viewpoint, but I don't. Mm-hmm. And so therefore it's important for me to talk about what my viewpoint is. Otherwise you, with your lack of telepathy skills, would not know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, I was, you know, brought up like, Lutheran Missouri Synod, Christian, but I don't really like the way they roll on things. I kind of consider myself more spiritual / Gnostic Christian, because Gnostic is, the root word is gnosis, which means knowledge through experience, and I really think that that more accurately represents what Jesus was about. Jesus wasn't all like, oh, blindly believe in me, and if you don't, fuck you, you're gonna burn. You know, he was really all about applying love and applying appreciation and applying thankfulness and really being proactive in taking the concepts and being about the doing. Whereas he would always complain that, you know, the Pharisees do a lot of talky talk, but other than like shovel wealth into their pockets, what else do they do? Do they really do anything? No, they don't. They do a lot of talk, but they don't really walk the walk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's all about, like, you know, practical and applied, which is another, you know, the only way Katerina and I are integrating is that what money, power, sex is going to be about. Money, power, sex is all about applied spirituality. That's the whole thing.
And I believe that the point of Jesus was not, oh, believe in him and he suffered for you so you don't have to. No, we live in a world of suffering. This is a world of suffering. That's not what Jesus did. What Jesus, I think the point he was making is that he came off of his cross of suffering and so can we, that we can paradigmally resurrect into, you know, something better than we were, that the old mind prison entrapped person that we used to be can, instead of be perpetually suffering on our cross of misery, can die on that cross, and we can then be reborn, resurrected into that new state of being, that new state of awareness, that Christ consciousness, you know, whatever. And, you know, I don't think
that it means, oh, well, you know, Jesus died for your sins, so let's not disappoint him, haha. You know, I don't believe that, oh, if I believe in the scapegoat, you know, social title called Christ, I could just, you know, I can do all this crazy shit and I'm saved, quote unquote, no matter what. But, you know, if I don't believe in the social title, then even if I was a totally good person, that this pissed off, supposedly unconditionally loving toddler God that is nothing but like Hitler on steroids is just going to toss me into a pit of fire if I, you know, so much as, you know, hold my dick the wrong way when I piss or whatever. And it's like, I don't believe in all that. And, you know, there's so many Christians that believe in that dysfunctional sort of God, you know, and they just don't really resonate with my view of God. And they're like worried that I might be going to hell or whatever. And it's just like, well, if you're right and I'm wrong, then so be it. But I just can't bring myself to believe that the universe is so poorly designed and that God is just this divine Nazi tormentor that is worse than an abusive parent. It's just going to be like, all right, I'm going to put all my kids down on earth and like not give them shit. And like, they got to like blindly poke around. And like, if they fall into any of the holes and traps because they can't see, then, oh, well, I'm just going to throw them in a pit of hell to burn for all eternity. No, I don't. I'm sorry. I don't believe in that kind of a God. And I think that shit is just us anthropomorphizing our human insecurities onto something we perceive as greater than us. So we create this big divine Nazi in order so that we can, you know, justify our own bullshit. We project that onto God, and that's just not the way God is, in my opinion. That's, I can't really, you know, see that as being real or plausible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and when it comes right down to it, I feel like you can either believe in a God that you understand, or you can believe in an omnipotent God, but you can't believe in both. The God that is omnipotent is by definition beyond my understanding. And consequently, any ideas that I have about God are necessarily limited.
Yeah, so it basically boils down to, you know, you can either believe that you know, a being, or at the very least a consciousness or a force or an energy of some sort has created and or is a part of and or controls or defines or whatever a universe that is so well designed that level of perfect function is well beyond our current capability to understand, and therefore would not be subject to all of the various dysfunctions that we look around at ourselves and say, okay, we have that, so God must have that too. I think it's just the ultimate in psychological projection, and I think it's really stupid.
Yeah, be careful about making God in your own image.
Okay, the audio just went weird on me for a second. Was that your end or mine?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Oh, there we go. You're back.
I had just said, be careful about creating God in your own image. It's like the Bible talks about God creates man in God's image, and then man turns right around and creates God in man's image.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, looking at it objectively, like all these different sub-denominations of Christianity, and then you've got, you know, the Muslim religion and, you know, Buddhism and this, that, and whatever. It's like, you know, like look at all the top religions that have like the most followers, and then they have all these sub-denominations and whatever that also believe as differently as they believe, you know, the same thing. They believe different too. It's like out of all these tons of different choices, if you ask the question, which one is the ultimate absolute right one? It's like,
you know, if you look at that logically, you can only come to the conclusion that they're all just as right as they are wrong, that they all have similarities and differences.
Possibly come to is that it's grace. It's that this benevolent thing that created us has in its own benevolent grace has already decided what the hell's going to happen, and it's going to be for our good. Because do you believe in a benevolent God or you believe in a not so benevolent one? And since you don't have a choice in the matter, pick the nicer one.
People always ask, well, if God was so benevolent, why would bad things be allowed to happen? Well, that's an easy one. Free will. Without free will, then God would be the divine Nazi. He would be like, well, everything has to be this way and you don't get a choice. But we have free will. And so that is what allows for that, because our free will is not going to be interfered with. So if we choose to do something nasty, we have the free will to do that. That doesn't mean God is doing something nasty.
Well, it also doesn't mean that, it doesn't even mean that it's particularly nasty. It simply means that we perceive it that way. That we have made our own judgment call as to being like, this is nothing. Murdering somebody is nasty. When in fact, murdering somebody may very well be the absolute best thing that could have possibly happened to them. And thus, it was all foreordained a long time ago, before time itself, and is inherently good, though we perceive it as being bad or nasty.
Well, I also don't necessarily think that it was necessarily inherently good any more than it was inherently bad. Sometimes it's simply a matter of consequences for actions. You allow tyrants in control, you're going to get things like genocide and other stuff. Like, you touch fire, you get burned. It's not that the fire is punishing you for touching it. It's just a consequence for action. So if you don't want things like genocide, then don't let tyrants rule over you and stop giving tyrants power. So I don't think that that lesson is good or bad. It's just like fire isn't good or bad. It's, you know, it's just fire burns. If you don't want to get burned, don't touch it. It's, you know.
Can I read something that just came up on my feed about, this is really cool. This is very interesting. Sure. It's called 11-22-33 Degrees of Kundalini Consciousness. It's a Gnostic Kundalini teaching.
Okay.
And it ties in, like, spirituality very well here. Kundalini is because of the energy that facilitates all spiritual development. The Kundalini is at the base of all existence. It is the raw foundational energy that the spiritual seeker wants to cultivate, develop, or awaken, depending on which tradition or term they use. The word Kundalini is most known from the Sanskrit language, yet it is even more ancient than that language. It has roots that go back to Atlantis and beyond. Kundalini refers to a cosmic force, an energy unlike any energy that we know physically. Kundalini's not mere electricity or magnetism or heat, but it is the source of them all. Kundalini is a kind of force or energy that is pure, divine, raw potentiality that is then modified according to its condition. This is the key fact that is often missing in many texts or schools of Hinduism or Buddhism who discuss Kundalini. In the West, Kundalini is also a basic foundational aspect of religion, but it is more veiled. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, it is symbolized as the fire of the Holy Spirit, or the column of fire that led the Israelites in their great exodus. In reality, any spiritual practice that we perform, any kind, whether recitation of mantras, meditation, prayer, devotional singing, karma yoga, or selfless service, all of these spiritual practices, no matter what tradition it comes from, has its intention the awakening of this cosmic force within us. There is no exception to this. The very purpose of religion or yogis to awaken this energy inside of, or purpose of religion or yoga is to awaken this energy inside of the person. We seek to activate that force because that energy connects us to the divine. It produces in us what can be called enlightenment or liberation. However, do not confuse this with realization, which depends on cognizance, wisdom, and understanding. The energy of Kundalini is not active in people today. That is because the conditions that activate it have not been satisfied. Like any energy or force in nature, the energy of Kundalini, the Holy Spirit, functions according to the laws of nature. It functions according to cause and effect. Everything in nature, even God, respects the law of cause and effect. Karma, this law of action and consequence, modifies everything. Every manifested thing is subject to cause and effect. Kundalini is no exception. The arising of Kundalini works like any law in nature. When the causes are satisfied, the effects result. This is why, when we observe society and the world, we see the psychological and spiritual level of humanity where it is because of cause and effect. Humanity is where it is because of the causes that humanity has created. Our current situation, whether social, economic, or political, every aspect of our life is as it is because of our actions. There is no exception to that. There is nothing beyond being imposed upon, that there's nothing being imposed upon us from outside. Everything we experience is the result of what we are inside. The same is true of the awakening of Kundalini. This cannot occur by the intervention of any outside force. There are groups that state that Kundalini is dangerous, that it can be awakened by accident. This is false. It is impossible. Why? Because Kundalini is the intelligence of God. God does not act by accident. Enlightenment or liberation does not come by accident. Enlightenment is a result of precise causes. To produce those causes requires great effort and a lot of knowledge. God, divinity, the divine mother, does not enlighten anyone randomly by accident or on a whim. Therefore, we can dispense with a huge expanse of books, theories, schools, and teachers who repeat all of this nonsense about Kundalini. What we should do is study the actual scriptures, the experiences of those who have truly worked with this energy and who have the corresponding sign, brilliant purity, wisdom, and radiant intelligence, and rely upon their guidance. We should set aside those people who are just trying to make money, gather followers, or become famous. When we examine the scriptures and the great teachers, both past and present, we discover that this force of Kundalini, the Holy Spirit, is extremely powerful, but also extremely demanding. It only enlightens those who deserve it. Those who deserve the presence of that force within enter into a very different experience of life. Someone who has this energy active within them does not see life the way a common person does. And these are from the Gnostic teachings.
Yeah, totally. I think they're also kind of talking about what Einstein referred to as the ether and what modern science refers to as the zero-point field, like the source of all. Science is even starting to realize, kind of getting into the thought that instead of space being that which is between matter, as if space is just some empty nothing, and that, you know, you've got space and then matter in the space, but the space itself is nothing. They're starting to think that, you know, because they're seeing that the universe is an electric universe, and that physical reality is more holographic, that space is where matter is actually projected from, like, you know, the projector in the back of a movie theater projecting the experience to the screen. That space, that what we call space, is that which reality is projected from, and not just simply empty nothingness that exists between the something. Mm-hmm. So science is starting to look at it a little more in that direction, at least the aspects of science that are getting away from Newtonian absolutism and realize that things work electrically, not like billiard balls.
Mm-hmm.
So on that level, you realize that excuse me, thoughts, emotions, beliefs, everything
it's all energy. It all interacts with everything else. There are configurations, and as I like to say, you know, reality is a cake, not a light switch. So the configuration of ingredients is going to determine, you know, what type of cake you get. So it's kind of along those lines.
Yeah.
Oh, it is almost 4 in the morning and I'm starting to get really super sleepy, and you're probably able to tell.
Yeah. How about we wrap this up?
Yep. Sounds good. Too bad Rich was only able to stay for a short time, but he'll be with us again another time. So catch you guys later. I'm sure I can use my imagination as far as determining what you guys are about to go do. And as for everybody else watching, everybody have a good day, night, whatever it is on your part of the planet while you're watching this. And
bye-bye.
Bye.
Catch y'all later.